us today is that the Holy Spirit touch each and every one of us. We've got bulletins, there's all kinds of stuff going on that I want you to pay attention to this morning. The yellow sheet is about our fall Bible study and disciple. Would you like to speak to that for just a second?
Well, go ahead.
Okay.
I'll
all right. And in your bulletin also is the announcement sheet, and it's absolutely full. Blood pressure monitoring, you can get your blood pressure checked after this worship service. The annual missions dinner and silent auctions, this is what our choir is pointing out to us with their net adornment, a lady, right? Okay.
And Craig has something to share.
And Craig has something else to share with that. Where is Craig? Would you like to say to this?
I just want to tell everybody. Just want to tell everybody we're looking forward to it. And the tickets are going fast, so if you haven't bought one, see Miss Cornelia this morning. She's ready to sell one to you. If you buy one, she'll buy you a boomer.
She said yes.
If I understand correctly, you're still looking for items to be donated to auctions, correct?
Right.
Last night,
right.
We thought.
So y'all look at the stuff in your home. You may not want any more or go out.
No.
We bought a beautiful cross last year, and it's in our home, and we just absolutely love it. Please silence your phones. I totally trust that y'all are able to look through this. Don, you want to take your turn and talk to us just a little bit about disciple?
Yes, I do. Is this on?
It's on.
Okay. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'm here. I will be facilitating disciple one. On the table you saw as you came in, we've got everything on the table talking about disciple one, two, three, four, and Jesus in the Gospels and Christian believers, which are two more studies that we're offering, which are exciting. Since I'm facilitating disciple one, I won't be able to do the others, but I will in time. But I just wanted to tell you to pick up a sheet and look at it, and I'm doing disciple one, so I'm going to use that as my base that I talk about. We've all done a Bible study of some type, right?
Yeah.
Okay. That would be kind of isolating or looking at one part of the scriptures in the Bible that we all want to concentrate on for the most part. Disciple one takes the entire Bible. It goes front and back. I kind of equate it to a road map. If you get on, say, I-1 at Exodus, you drive all the way down I-1 to Leviticus, and everything in between, you might have exits off that interstate that you can stop in and take a look at and study more. Now, we don't read every verse of the Bible, but we really cover everything pretty darn well. It gives you an idea God's work and how it relates to you in your everyday life. And I think that's very important. And at this time, I'd like to ask our sister Laura McCarthy. She is versed in Bible study, and I want you to tell everybody what your experience has been.
Hi. Some of new faces, Laura and my husband, Jinster. Corey is a homeschool kid, and when I was trying to teach him Bible, we use a lot of homeschool curriculum and things. When we got to the high school age, I was starting to dip myself into Disciple One for the first time, and I was amazed at the amount of history, isn't it? And I was kind of a history nut, and so is my husband, and Corey's kind of a history nut.
just more information, a little more information. What the class, Disciple One will, and the others will too, will follow pretty much the school year, and it will start sometime after Labor Day. Don't know yet, because what we'll do is get everyone together that wants to take a Disciple One or other classes, and we'll all decide amongst ourselves what's the best day and time to do the class. So that's still open for discussion and decision making, but it'll follow those. The school year pretty much will take time off for holidays, and you know, there might be a couple of times during the year that we just take a break. I mean, everybody needs a break. But I don't think you can go wrong either with Disciple One or any of the other disciples I talk about. So stop by the table and ask me about Disciple. Thank you.
Well, all right. You can ask me about Disciple too, folks. Because I had never read the Bible. My wife gave me a Bible 1 year for Christmas. And I looked at her and I said, what is this for? But I can tell you and I can promise you, if you enroll yourself in one of these disciple classes and put your heart into it, it will absolutely change your life. And getting into God's Word is what we're about. I do want to tell you, though, the God of the universe loves us. How about that? How awesome is that to realize that? And we're one little church in one little community, but God is here, and He thinks that we are special. And that's where I'm hanging my hat. So let's have a moment of quiet reflection.
Wait. We got it on film.
God, we are in awe
of the gifts and graces that you have poured out in this young man, for his strength, for his focus, for his character, and for who he is in your eyes. And we just ask you to be with him now as we release him. Lord, I know it's hard for his family. They've been so close. But that closeness has given him the strength to be who he is today. Go with him as he goes forward into the world. As he goes into this training, God, sustain him in ways that he knows it's you that's carrying him. Protect him because he is yours and you desire good for him. Watch over him and bless him and bring him back with a new and richer understanding of who he is for the world and for you. All of these things we ask, we pray in your holy name. And all of God's people say,
amen.
Just remember that yes, you're a sergeant, not a servant.
Yes, finally, finally got eye levels. These are occasions in the life of the church that are sacred to me because you've all invested in growing and learning, and now we get to see the fruits. Not till Christmas.
December 12th,
but who's counting? I've got a friend that keeps record of how many days that you're
She's counting.
Excellent. Well, we'll look for hopefully some updates that we'd be glad to share with the church family in December. All 20 pages. The sacred moment is always with us as we worship God and pray. I know that you have come with thoughts and concerns on your mind, and I pray too that we will trust that the Lord has bent his ear to us now and always. Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would just surround this church with your mercy and your grace. Make our hearts tender for you and you alone. Draw us together as your people in a way that transforms us for your glory. We have no idea what it is that you have planned for us, but we trust you. That today is before us and tomorrow is yet to be, but you hold all of that in your hands. We ask you to be with those who are ill, who are recovering, who are suffering, who are asking questions and are too afraid to ask. God, send your spirit. Give us discernment and wisdom to be those who can offer comfort. And Lord, let us point to you for the answers. God, we pray for this country and this world. As we turn our hearts and minds toward the missionaries that our hearts tell us are called by you to serve you in places around the world. We have so much, Lord. We have so much more than most all of the world. And the courage of these young families and parents who go out and serve in difficult circumstances. We pray that you would help us to join them by supporting them financially and praying for them. May we ask, Lord, that you allow us to give to them with free and joyful abandon, seeing that your work is being done in the holy places where pain and sorrow and questions fester. God, you are with them, and we pray their protection and their strength. God, these are troubled days. We see evil all around. But we do know you, and we know that you triumph. So triumph with us as we turn to you. Draw us together with your words as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And I invite our ushers to come forward. As they come forward, let us give thanks with joy and appreciation.
Thank you.
said to the rich man, he said, "You fool. There you go again. You lost your perspective. You forgot where to look. Didn't look down." But you see, as we go through the scripture and we look at God's word, we find that there are many occasions when Jesus pulls out the very best, the essence of what he desires us to know. And there's always learning, isn't there, from the day we are born till the day we die. And unfortunately, this happens very surprisingly for almost all of us. I think we have a skill, I do, for living in that world of denial, that no, my end will not come, but it will. And this scripture today reminds us that we all have that moment of facing our mortality. I'll be reading from Luke chapter 12, beginning with the 13th verse. I'll invite you to stand as you are able as I read the word of God for us on this day. Someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbiter for you?" And he said to them, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly. And he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, 'Soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you, and the things you have prepared, whose will they be?' So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Jesus, won't you please fix this? I've said it. I've prayed it. I've thought it. And this person in the crowd was just voicing what we all at one time or another do, and that is go to Jesus and say, "Intervene and straighten the other person out." Now, of course, Jesus does what Jesus always does. He puts it into perspective. The first thing is he absolutely refuses to be his judge or arbiter. He wants the someone in the crowd to get a perspective that he has completely lost. He calls attention to a bigger issue. There is conflict, and I know this from my own family experience. It's just the way it is when there is a change in the dynamics of family, and particularly in a death. There are times that things get not so pretty, right? God bless those who can do that without any of that. I'll share my memory of that. I don't say that I remember a lot about my childhood, but we were still in Virginia. My parents had built a house, and my grandmother, my father's mother, lived in the basement. And I don't remember too much. She did seem to travel a fair amount. But I remember that I would go downstairs and visit with her and spend time with her. She was special to me. And for some unknown reason, and we moved when I was going into the third grade, so I was fairly young. I remember that she said this one day to me, or more than once, "This bed set is yours," her personal bed, and bed frame was real pretty. And she said, "This is yours." Well, that didn't mean a whole lot to me. Okay, fine. It didn't until she passed away, and I remember being in my parents' bedroom looking out the back window and watching someone take that bed set away and being brokenhearted and saying, why are they taking what my grandmother promised those conflicts come about and they leave us feeling bitter or unhappy or unfulfilled. This someone in the crowd definitely felt like he'd gotten, if for no other better way of saying it, the short end of the stick. Well, that's the way it was in that time anyway. The older brother got 2/3 of whatever the leavings were, and the others got 1/3 of whatever was left. That doesn't even mention the fact that women got nothing. So there was a lot of disparity in who got what when, and that person was struggling. And it continues today. But as Laura said, the words of the Old Testament and the New come back alive again as we take a look at this. And Jesus does it so beautifully. He just puts that out there. He just leaves it there. Here's a parable. There was a rich man. Already we understand that this person lives better than probably 95% of the world. I tried to get some statistics for you, but all I can tell you is the bottom line, we are richer as a country than most all of the world by significant gains. And within this country, there is a small percentage that has about 44% of the large wealth, but we all live well compared to the world. This rich man had everything he needed and more, to the point where he couldn't even keep it all together. And that was so upsetting that he decided he better do something bigger and better. And that was to build more barns to store for the future. And then now I know where that saying comes from: eat, drink, and be merry. Right out of the Bible. That was his answer to being sure that he had enough, was that once he garnered that amount and set it before him, he could also watch it, couldn't he? He could eat, drink, and be merry, and not worry about today or tomorrow. It sounds like the American dream, doesn't it? We all believe that retirement is that time that's due us. And it's not. But the way of life in America has said that we will figure out a way, and that we will save, and then we will eat, drink, and be merry. And the reality is that God asks us to see a much bigger picture than just ourselves. You see, the man had one thing that he revealed right away. If you counted the eyes in here, you might get a perspective that he had lost his. Everything was I, mine. Everything was about what was important to him. He had forgotten the very elemental thing of life and lost it. I think he lost his soul. Jesus uses the shock factor. Yes, yeah, that was all about just making sure we had some shock this morning. God looked at this man who thought he had everything in place and said, "You fool." I thought to myself coming in today, that's the last thing we want to hear from God, isn't it? You fool. Oh, talk about a shock factor. Just as we began to believe that we have done all that we should and can and done it well, God reminds us that there is more to do than take care of ourselves. And he does it through this rich man. And we may not be the rich man with all the barns, but we still have the same accountability that this man has. This parable brings us to an undeniable point. How is our perspective today? Now the thing is, we don't hear the answer that he has toward God, do we? We're left wondering, does he work it out? Does he come to himself and beg God to allow him to do more and better with what he has? We don't know. What went wrong in his life? Then I ask, how can I not thing that God did indeed bless him with, he forgot very quickly. And it's easy to do. This parable reminds us that we must hold fast to our own awareness of our relationship with God and of how all that we have and all that we are and all will ever be comes from God. And out of that knowledge should spring within us an undeniable heart of gratitude and joy and thanksgiving and a recognition that we want to do the very best we can to give thanks to God. Not bringing the last fruits and the fruits that have died on the vine, but the very first fruits that come into our lives are deserving to be presented to God with glory and thanksgiving. Not withholding, but gaining a perspective of the fact that all that we have belongs to God in the first place. And ask ourselves, what would God have us do? Would God have us give in joy and build the kingdom of God? And how will we do that? We begin to take on the heart of Christ, and we begin to see the world and all of its needs, understanding that everything that we do can be for God's glory, and that when we give, when we feed, when we comfort, when we nurture, when we do those things with abandon, we are doing as God has asked us to do. We are keeping perspective. Today is one of those days, I guess. I'm so sorry. Try to cover it. I guess I won't be serving communion today. You see, the problem with the man is that the things that he did so well become his. And the acquiring took the final step. He moved to greed. That's what we may be hearing. I can't say for sure, and the someone who asked Jesus to even things out. Greed is an ugly thing. It makes us do things that we would not normally do because it's so important to have. It's so important to gain. Yes, I'm talking about money. Yes, I'm talking about things, but I'm talking about it's so important to have control. I can't help but think of whoever it was that shot those people. And deep down in his heart, the need that must have driven him, that drove out all semblance of humanity and love and compassion, the greed to be in control, the greed to take control and harm. You see how far it can go? That's not what we're hearing here, but we know that in the ways of greed, we lose ourselves. And we don't see God. That's what God saw. So the question for us today is, how are we to be rich with God? How are we doing? I won't call you fools. You are fine people. You have hearts of generosity like none I have ever experienced. Our missions is a perfect example. Because all of that is far beyond our giving of tithing. It's out of our heart, believing that these young people and these families are committed and called by God, and that we have the privilege. We are going to be asked to consider to take on yet another missionary. And in all semblance of reasonableness, we might just say that, you know, we've got three. I don't know. But you know what? I say God calls us to bigger and better. Because you know why? But we can be the people of God and send.
Amen.
Amen. And there is such joy in knowing that this church is able and that we can do it with such joy. I encourage you to be at that dinner, at the auction. Hey, bid with abandon. Give more than you think that thing's worth. As a matter of fact, do give more than it's worth. It's not about the gain of the night, it's about the gain of the kingdom of God. Amen. And then that Sunday, right after that Friday, that Saturday night meal, Caleb will come and speak to us. And you will get to hear from him. Folks, this is what being rich with God is about. It's about truly seeing the work of God in the lives of people and joining with them. There is no greater joy than joining together to do the work of God. So how can we know we're rich? Well, you can have those barns. That's okay. Floyd, don't worry. I know you've got a barn. Of course, I've heard what's in it. We can have our barns and our savings. That's not what is being convicted here. That we have not invested in our soul work, in our relationship with God. Being rich with God. Well, these are the points I saw, and I hope you'll share some you've gained too, because God will speak to you in a different way. But being rich with God is like being able to embrace God's love and let it move through our hearts and change us. Take up residence. Trust in God. Not only for today, but for tomorrow. Adore God with all your heart. For in that love, you are rich. For God returns that love manyfold over. Being rich with God changes our priorities. From gathering and holding and controlling to giving and freeing and releasing. Nothing is ours. It's all God's. And being rich with God means that we live and love generously and lavishly and with joy. So I say, yes, there is that moment we will all come. And I believe that our relationship with God deserves our focus,